ladies and gentlemen. It's absolutely fantastic to see so many of you here this evening. Welcome to a rather special Thursday night debate with Debsock. Well done for travelling in the cold and for coming here this evening. It's great to see such a good turnout. Very glad people remembered the change of day and room. It looked like everyone remembered the change of day and room, which is good to see. Certainly spotted a few new faces, a lot of new faces. So for people who are new to Debsock, my name's Ness, I'm president of the society. And we hold a show debate like this every single week, a new controversial motion and four new exciting speakers. So tonight is no different to any other week, but it is slightly in the fact that we are doing it in association with XTV. They will be filming and live streaming tonight's debate. So hello to anybody watching from home. We're very excited to have such an esteemed panel with us this evening. So a big welcome to our panel, and thankfully they got here even despite the floods. Also, just a quick reminder, if you want to write a review for tonight's debate, not only do Expose want them, but Exeter Express and Echo want them as well. So write a review, send them to me, send them straight to them, and reviews are wanted. So hopefully people will want to tonight, considering our debate. So without further ado, I'll pass you on to Jono, our chairman, for tonight's debate.
Thank you very much for coming this evening, and congratulations to most of you who found the right room. We only had to redirect about 15 people or so. On the panel this evening, on the proposition to your left, we have Peter Reynolds, leader of the Cannabis Law Reform Party and recently stood in the Corby by-election, and Stephen Davies, the Education Director at the Institute for Economic Affairs. And on the opposition this evening, on your right, we have Peter Hitchens, noted author and columnist for the Mail on Sunday, and David Raynes, former Her Majesty's Customs Assistant Chief Investigation Officer, member of the International Task Force on Strategic Drug Policy. Again, thank you for coming, but now I'm going to bore you all with the rules as I usually do. Each speaker has 5 minutes of uninterrupted time. So in those 5 minutes, please no outburst questions from the audience or other panellists, as we've had before. And then there will be a question and answer round. Not all of you can see, but this bottle of wine is unfortunately not for my benefit, but for my favourite question. So do think of a good one, and you may well be walking home with it. We will then move on to summations from both sides. We'll have two votes this evening, one at the end of the debate to determine the winning side, which will be a vote based on the merits of the arguments you've heard. But we hold two votes, one we'll hold right now, which will be based on your conscience. You may abstain in this vote, so without further ado, the motion is as behind me. If you're voting with the proposition, please raise your hand nice and high so I can count them easily. And those voting with the opposition, please. And all those abstaining.
I was amazed when we last did this, when they did the study.
Yes. Save that to use a hand on all the things that we have.
They're the ones you want. I wonder if you could check to see how many of them voted twice.
A surprising number. So without further ado, the motion is behind me. No more than 5 minutes, please. The proposition, Peter Reynolds.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Today has been a day of considerable notes already, with the Leveson report, and of course with the fantastic news that Palestine is closer to being an independent nation than ever before. So I hope that, given that fantastic beginnings of the day, I hope that I and indeed all of us can do justice to that. Now the first thing I would want to say is to talk about the word legalise, because the word legalise is usually interpreted as meaning a free-for-all, and that is not what I advocate at all. What I advocate is in fact more control over the cannabis market than we have at the moment, because prohibition, our current policy, provides no control at all. But so first, for a moment, I'd just like to reflect on the great tragedy the cannabis prohibition has been, and specifically in Britain. Last year, in England and Wales, 396 people were sent to jail immediately for the simple possession of cannabis. In 2010, it was 350 people. And in the last 5 years, 1,174 people have suffered the appalling cruelty and injustice of being forcibly locked up for nothing more than the possession of a few dried flowers or resin. Even worse, I would estimate that about a third of them are probably using it for medicinal reasons. So please, I'd ask you now, would you rise? And can we remember, please, those 1,200 people in jail? Let's remember a total of 1 million people in Britain with a criminal record for cannabis, whose careers and lives may be blighted forever by that. And the hundreds of thousands...
Why don't we have 2 minutes silence for them?
The hundreds of thousands... I only want 10 seconds. But I do want us just to remember those people who've been blighted by the great evil that is cannabis prohibition. Thank you. So is cannabis dangerous or harmful? Because this is really the nub of the issue. And I don't think, not in any way, not by any definition can one describe cannabis as dangerous, but it would be wrong to say that it can't be harmful. Anything can be harmful. Cannabis wasn't banned in the first place because it was harmful. It had nothing to do with that at all. In Europe, it was banned at the behest of Egyptian cotton farmers. And in America, it was banned at the behest of the oil and timber barons, most particularly at the behest of the alcohol prohibition industry, who in 1933, of course, found themselves all out of a job with nothing to do. So these vested interests all coincided, and they developed a strategy to demonise cannabis, to claim it drives you crazy, to claim that it makes white women promiscuous with black men, that it's the devil's weed. And it's still going on today. You can look, you know, with due respect, you can see the Daily Mail almost every day. In fact, this week, you can see the Independent. You can see the same ludicrous, scaremongering nonsense endlessly repeated by journalists, most of whom, present company excepted, know full well that they're misleading their readers. None of it, absolutely none of it, is supported by evidence. For adults, cannabis is without doubt the least harmful psychoactive substance on the planet. Compare it to our most popular drug, alcohol, and it's like comparing a pea shooter to a high-velocity rifle. Now, the only purpose of a drugs policy must be to reduce harm. And that is why this House would legalise, or as I would prefer to put it, legally regulate cannabis. I have four reasons for you. And what I'd like to do is, I've only got 5 minutes, so what I want to do is tell you those four reasons straight away, and then I'll go back in them over detail. So the first reason we should legalise cannabis is to enable its enormous medicinal and therapeutic benefits. The second reason is to protect children and the vulnerable. The third reason is to minimise all social harms. And the fourth reason is to save public expenditure and increase tax revenue. Science explains why cannabis has been used for medicine for over 5,000 years. We now know that in our bodies is a thing called the endocannabinoid system. And cannabinoids regulate our cardiovascular system, our central nervous system, our immune system, our reproductive system. They're essential and fundamental to life. And this explains, as I say, why it's played such an important part in history. And 99% of people, when you talk to them about medicinal cannabis, can't understand why people aren't allowed to have it prescribed to them by their doctor. And we're the only country in Europe, apart from France, where that's the case. Second reason is to protect children and the vulnerable. And quite, you know, as I've said, cannabis isn't harmless. The people who are most vulnerable to it are children. When the brain's developing, it has a property called plasticity, which means that anything that happens to it, any life experience, any substance, can alter the way it develops. Professor Terry Moffat at the Institute of Psychiatry said recently, cannabis may be risky for under-18s, but safe for the over-18 brain. So what we must do is regulate cannabis to protect children. Take it away, because the only ID that a dealer asks for is a £20
note. I'm sorry, Mr. Reynolds.
Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much, Mr. Reynolds. And now moving over to the opposition, please, Peter Hitchens.
Good evening. I first encountered Peter Reynolds when he started writing me incessant letters and emails about the things that I'd written about the drug that he so wrongly and wickedly promotes and supports. And I got the impression after a while that he actually thought he was cannabis, since he took offence at any criticism of it, whatever. And I have to say that you sometimes wonder. But I would like very, very briefly, because I don't have very much time, to deal with several of the points that you made. And I will try and do so as briskly as possible so that we can make sure that this is a serious debate. But before I do, I want to conduct two very brief opinion polls of my own. The first one is, how many people in this room have smoked or in any other way taken cannabis? You have no reason to be quiet about it. It's legal in this country, effectively, already. Right, okay. And the other next question is, how many of you have a completely closed mind? Right, you're going to have to prove that you haven't got one of those, because this is one of the most important debates before us now. It is besieged with lies. The first lie is that we are under some tremendous regime of wicked prohibition, in which you can be somehow or other conned by Mr. Reynolds into standing up and giving a minute's silence to a bunch of people who broke a known law and got prosecuted for it. Actually, of the 160,000 people who were prosecuted in the last year, or not prosecuted, but arrested in the last year, for which there are figures for cannabis, only a tiny minority experienced anything remotely resembling punishment. Most were given something called a cannabis warning, which doesn't even have the sanction of Parliament, and which means that you're let off. There is no prohibition. As long ago as 1994, John O'Connor, a former head of the Flying Squad, said that cannabis was a decriminalised drug. So if someone like that says it, I think you can take it as gospel. It goes back much further than that, to 1973, when Lord Hailsham, then Lord Chancellor, that well-known Trotskyist, instructed the magistrates to stop sending people to prison for cannabis possession. There is no prohibition. What we have now is the biggest experiment in decriminalisation in an advanced country anywhere in the world. What is now wanted by the immensely powerful and extraordinarily wealthy campaign which stands behind Mr. Reynolds and
check my wallet.
What is now demanded by them is legalisation. For what reason? Not to make it easier for you to smoke dope in your squalid hovels, which you can already do without fear of any kind of serious penalty or detection. What they want to do is to make it easier for very, very big business to market, advertise, and sell in an extraordinarily wide manner to people young and old all over the Western world one of the most dangerous drugs in existence. I say dangerous for a very simple reason. Because of my friend Patrick Coburn and his son Henry, who I've known for a very long time, and I knew Henry before he had the misfortune to go to an English school, where at the age of 11 he was introduced and put under strong peer pressure to smoke cannabis. And any of you who read The Independent and the very fine series of articles denigrated by Mr. Reynolds just now, by Patrick, who is one of the finest journalists now living and probably the most distinguished foreign correspondent in this country, if you read that, you would find out that what happened to Henry following that was a complete and utter disaster. He is now permanently, and will be for the rest of his life, on powerful antipsychotic drugs, which have changed his nature and indeed the shape of his body. He is completely denied the things which most of you hope for in life, and this is because irresponsible people fail to prevent or provide any weapon for people resisting this drug. One of the main reasons for maintaining the law, apart from preventing the plutocrats from flooding the world with even more of it and making immense amounts of money out of human misery, having been denied the chance to do so with tobacco anymore, they've found another poison. One of the main reasons for doing this is to provide a reason for people like you to resist the immense fashionable peer pressure to smoke a drug which can easily ruin your lives. And in doing so, if you don't care about that and think that you have a right to put whatever you wish into your own body, in doing so, ruin the lives of those who love you. Which is why cannabis is not a victimless crime. Cannabis smoking, if it affects you badly, as it may, and I had only the other day a letter from a woman whose husband, who had been smoking it without consequence for 20 years, suddenly went mad and had to be dragged from the house by 12 police officers, thought it was safe. All his friends have given it up now, too late for him. If you think that it okay to put it into your own body and that the only victim will be you, don't imagine that for a moment. Somebody else who loves you will have to take the consequences. The law which exists, weak as it is a small protection against that. Far from being abandoned, we should strengthen it. Thank you very much.
you very much, Mr. Hitchens. And now the second proposition speaker, Stephen Davies, please.
Thank you, Chair. Well, I am glad to argue for this motion because I believe that the case for legalising cannabis is so strong that even if, in fact, you concede all of the points that Peter just made, you should still vote for the motion. Let me concede at the outset, then, for the purposes of argument, that cannabis is both highly risky and dangerous, and that it is, in some sense, an immoral act to take it regularly because it will have bad effects on your life and the life that you will lead is not a good one. Even so, I would argue that we should still legalise the substance. For one thing, let me point out, there are many, many things which are both immoral and harmful, not only to the person who does them, but to others around them. Take, for example, adultery, something which is definitely immoral, most people think so anyway, and which has significant bad effects, both for the people who are engaged in it and for other people, notably very often their children. Does anybody reasonably suggest that we should therefore make it illegal and subject to criminal sanctions? No. And why not? Because we know that were we to do so, just as were we to outlaw tobacco, another substance that is both dangerous and arguably immoral in the sense that it has effects on others and can be very bad for your life, were we to do so, the effects would actually be worse than the disease. And in fact, you would make the disease itself worse. Peter Hitchens says we do not have a regime of prohibition. We have effective decriminalisation. I may even concede that as well. What I would say is decriminalisation is actually the worst of both worlds, because while you have effective decriminalisation, the supply, distribution and sale of cannabis is still illegal. And what that means is that it is in the hands not of legitimate businessmen, the so-called plutocrats that he referred to, but rather criminals and extremely unsavoury people. The inevitable result of cannabis prohibition and of drug prohibition more widely is to fund and assist and lead to the creation of enormous organised crime networks. And it also has disastrous geopolitical effects. We may say there's no war on drugs here, but try saying that to people who live in Mexico, Colombia, many other parts of the world where thousands of people are being killed as a result of that war being fought on other people's soil. The basic fact is that if the demand for any activity or substance is sufficiently high, the attempt to deal with any problems that that causes through the mechanism of the criminal law will actually make the problem worse. It will create more suffering, more problems of moral corruption, and generalised corruption of the entire criminal justice system upon which our society depends. I do not say that, therefore, there's no alternative. As you have heard from my supporter on this motion, there are ways you can deal with it. Nobody is talking about free for all. We are talking about legal regulation. Let me give you a historical example, to conclude with, of the alternative to this failed and morally corrupt system that we have now. In the 1820s, Britain had a truly desperate problem of alcohol abuse. If you think we have a problem with alcohol consumption now, you should read accounts of what Britain was like in the early 19th century. By the 1890s, Britain had become the most sober country in Europe. There had been an amazing decline in all of the problems associated with alcohol. This had been done not through prohibition, but through conscious action by government, particularly the use of the tax system to make certain kinds of alcohol more expensive and others cheaper, and also by civil society, through things like the temperance movement, moral campaigns which led to the widespread belief that to become drunk was simply not the action of a gentleman or a lady and utterly morally repugnant, and the development of social institutions such as the pub. That is the way in which you can deal with the kind of moral problems that we are dealing with here. To try and follow the path that Peter Hitchens is advocating and that the other side is advocating is to actually produce, as I've already said, problems that are worse than the ones that you may be trying to solve. You will in fact create a complete nightmare, as can be seen in many parts of the world, and you will certainly not achieve the kind of ends that Peter wants to realise. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Davies. And now closing for the opposition, please, David Raynes.
Thank you. Peter's the polemicist and I'm the pragmatist. I've got 36 years of experience of dealing with organised crime. And so I think, I venture to suggest to you, I do really know what I'm talking about. And organised criminality cannot be kept out of the cannabis market by legalising it. 25% of the UK tobacco market has been illegal, counterfeit, smuggled, or both. I was in charge of this region, Wales and the West Country, as the Assistant Chief Investigation Officer. Frequently in a month, I spent much more money dealing with tobacco smuggling than I did with cannabis smuggling. And yet, my officers caught the majority of the cannabis that was caught coming into the UK. So organised crime will not be dealt with by it. So that's a fiction. What I think these two have got to do on my right to get a change in the position on cannabis is they've got to demonstrate to you and to the country an overwhelming public good by their changes. And they've also got to demonstrate that what they will create will be less harmful than the present situation. Now let me just deal with some of the points that typically get made. I think they made most of these. That the total personal and social harm caused by illegality and regulation of certain drugs is worse than would ensue from legalisation on something like the tobacco alcohol model. Well, the total harm of the alcohol tobacco model is there for you all to see. You all know how bad it is. We all know that excepting for tobacco, the UK has one of the worst drugs problems in Europe. Excepting for tobacco, why is that? Well, because it's cultural. In Eastern Europe, 80 to 90% of people use tobacco. Here, it's about 20%, and it's saving for young women, it's declining. And we've taken some legal steps to control it. And we're thinking about doing that in respect of alcohol. The other point, that legalising one or more illegal drugs would substantially reduce the involvement of organised crime. Well, I've dealt with that. It won't. It doesn't. The most smuggled commodity in the world is tobacco, not drugs. But legalisation would reduce availability to children and the vulnerable young. Peter's quite right. Children, young people, are vulnerable. At the moment, we've got a whole raft of people in the prisons said to be mentally ill. How do they get to that situation? They get no education. They use cannabis from about the age of 11, 12 or 13. They use it on the way to school, at school and on the way home from school. They become beyond education. They become unteachable. They end up leaving school at 15 or 16 with no skills. The world is full of them. There's about a million of them on the unemployment register, those that are not in prison. So cannabis has contributed to that, and after cannabis, alcohol contributes as well. But cannabis is the starting point. And finally, the talk about peace dividends. Peter didn't actually talk about peace dividends. The peace dividend is the money that's spent on enforcement at the moment. Well, actually, any regime of legalisation of cannabis would actually need an army of inspectors. It would need an army of people in the department I used to work for in customs and now revenue and customs. It would need an army of people because legal sellers of cannabis would want protection from illegal sellers of cannabis. Why would there be illegal sellers of cannabis? Well, 80% of cannabis now in the UK is not smuggled in, it's grown here. And it's a different kind of cannabis, actually. It's very strong cannabis, very high in THC and very low in CBD. And that is, which is another one of the two main chemicals in cannabis, and that is one of the problems with cannabis. It is getting it's getting stronger and it's not got CBD in it. And in fact, the Dutch have just made strong cannabis effectively a Class A drug under their system. So cannabis is not harmless. It wasn't harmless in the 60s when a lot of my generation used it, and it's not harmless now. And really, the model that's being put before you is not practical. It won't happen. I'm very confident it won't happen. And the final thing I'd like to say is we're subject to international agreements. We're subject to the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child. We have a duty to protect young people, and we should protect young people. We should maintain illegality, because if we make it legal for adults, as Peter wants, we will create a desirable adult behaviour for young people to copy. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Raynes. And now we move over to our question and answer segment of the audience. I think, George, you're running around with a microphone, aren't you? Yes, it'll be fun. If you do have a question, raise your hand nice and high. Try and make it as short as possible so we can get through as many as possible, and I'm sure the panel will do the same with their answers. Joel.
Thank you, George. So we've heard a lot of arguments from the opposition about why cannabis is dangerous and thus why it should be illegal, but would they care to sort of elaborate about why those arguments don't apply to something like alcohol and why they do apply to cannabis? Or do you think it should apply to alcohol as well?
Good question.
We'll take turns on this. You have a go and I'll do it.
What I always say to that argument, we are where we are with alcohol and we are where we are with tobacco. You wouldn't start from here, particularly with tobacco. We are where we are with alcohol for historical reasons. Western Europeans' bodies have altered to adopt to alcohol because we used it. That was the only way we got pure water, but it was very weak alcohol.
But we've used cannabis for at least as long as we've used alcohol.
We didn't have any cannabis in the UK, Peter, so we haven't used it.
We have.
In the UK...
There's good evidence to show that Shakespeare used cannabis.
Just a simple point of comparison here. The quantity matter is important. Though I would say, I believe this argument about alcohol and cannabis is taught in PSHE classes in schools. I encounter it so often, it must have come from somewhere. You can't all have thought of it yourselves, because it's actually an unbelievably stupid argument, as I will now demonstrate. Alcohol in this country, and indeed in the United States, where a feeble attempt was made to make it illegal in the 1920s, has been part of the culture for thousands of years, and used by millions of people. And indeed, in America, there was a difficult problem of German-Americans and Italian-Americans seeing alcohol prohibition as an assault on their cultures. Plus the fact that I believe during Prohibition, 72 federal officers in the entire United States were actually put to work enforcing it. I don't think they meant it any more seriously than we mean our cannabis laws. I would personally, if I thought that it would, because in my trade you see people suffer from alcohol before your eyes. Terrible things I've seen happen to colleagues of mine from alcohol. I've seen colleagues carried urinating in their trousers.
So why shouldn't out of ban alcohol?
Let me finish. Don't interrupt me at my crucial point. I've seen colleagues of mine carried out of offices, wetting themselves, grown men, because of alcohol. I would cheerfully give it up myself tonight if I thought that banning it was at all a possible thing to do. But it isn't. What we did instead was have very effective alcohol licensing laws, crazily got rid of by the Tory government in the 1980s, which has led to the crisis we're in now. But the comparison, in 1951, in this country, there were 127 convictions for cannabis use in the entire United Kingdom. 127, a number that didn't increase greatly until 1965. That was the level of use of that drug in this country. Even now, despite the efforts of Mr. Reynolds and the rock music business, which promotes drug use all the time, despite this constant advertising campaign, even now an awful lot of people don't use it, and an awful lot of people have used it once and won't use it again. It still isn't anything like as common. You need to do something different with it. You can still, by the use of the law, stop it from becoming what alcohol has become. Now, to argue that because we already have two dangerous, stupid poisons at large in our society, we ought to have a third, seems to me to be the argument that only a really dim person could come up with, and only a really dim person could accept. So let's not have any more of that, shall we? It is absolute cobblers, and it doesn't deserve a second's consideration. It's not the point. We've got to. Do you want another one? Because if Mr. Reynolds and Mr. Davis get their way, you will have another one, and you'll live to regret it. I'll be dead by the time the worst of the problems are prevalent. You won't, and it'll be your children who are suffering.
How can it be morally justifiable how can it be morally justifiable to impose criminalisation on people for the consumption of a substance which is hundreds of times less harmful than alcohol? Cannabis has been around for at least as long as alcohol. You know, the earliest archaeological evidence of cannabis goes back to 2700 BC. It's just as embedded in our society, probably more embedded in our society than alcohol is. You know, you can't change it. It's a £6 billion market in this country. 30% of all adults will use cannabis in their lifetime. 3 million people in this country use cannabis regularly, at least once a week.
Well, could I just very, very quickly? I think the way both the previous speakers actually concede the point I would make, it's not a matter of saying we should legalise a third substance for which there is no existing demand. There's already a high demand and high usage for it, and that's the critical factor. If there is a low demand for a substance, then I think you can ban it without significant adverse effects. But then, by the same token, there isn't much of a problem anyway. Once the demand for the substance is high, you can only prohibit it by and produce a whole range of bad side effects. One of which, by the way, is that the illegal suppliers have very powerful incentives to sell the most powerful and toxic and condensed version of the product that they can find. That's why alcohol prohibition in the United States led the Americans to stop being a nation of beer drinkers and become a nation of hard liquor drinkers, because it was much easier and more effective for the bootleggers to sell hard liquor than beer. And so you actually make, as I said, the problem worse. So the point is, it's the level of demand that's the critical factor, and that is why we are not going to ban smoking, despite the fact it has serious adverse health results, because it's used by 20% of the population, as you heard. And similarly, the level of usage of cannabis is sufficiently high now that if you were to ban it, you would, as we do, you're going to have another whole range of bad results.
Shall I come back on those?
I'd like to come back on the word prohibition, actually, because you hear prohibition from that side of the debate a lot. You probably don't hear it from us two. The whole world of drugs politics is filled with what are called memes, planted words, and prohibition is actually a planted word. It was planted, first used in the States, it was planted to give you an idea that we're comparing like with like, we're comparing banning cannabis with banning alcohol, because there was an attempt at prohibition of alcohol. So it is a planted meme, and it's got into your head, and you believe it, and Peter clearly believes it, but it's nonsense.
A couple of things, if I could, just to come back quickly about the profound irresponsibility of this. Actually, cannabis is quite commonly used in some parts of this country, and it's one of the reasons why this audience should be particularly concerned about it, because the areas in this country where its use is most common and where it does most damage are in the poorest and most desolate and most hopeless parts of the country, where people suffer terribly in ways that the comfortable, well-educated middle class never do. And if you license it for yourselves, and if you support this motion, what you're doing is licensing it and making it much more prevalent among the poor and among those who will suffer from it, are already suffering from it terribly in educational terms, in social terms, in criminal terms. The damage that it is doing to their minds and to their lives and to the lives of their families is enormous. And by airily saying, oh, well, just for my pleasure, let's legalize this thing, you're doing a fantastically selfish and irresponsible act. And I think when you come to vote, you should very much bear in mind, occasions like this do have influence, that you, by putting your hand up for the legalization of Mr. Reynolds' filthy poison, will actually be doing damage to the lives of other people much less fortunate than you, who you will probably never meet.
Excuse me, I can't let that pass. There's a faulty logical argument there. The implication is that it's, to a great degree, the smoking of cannabis which is the cause of the conditions that Peter is talking about, when in fact it's not. It's due to economic deprivation and poverty. Oh. That's an argument in favour of doing something about poverty, not the economic crisis.
And you'll find that the prohibitionists, and I will use that word, the prohibitionists will endlessly ramble on about the massive harm that cannabis causes, but you'll find they'll never actually come up with any data. And the facts about the harm that cannabis causes to mental health are, for instance, there are just 700, and I'm not saying that every single one of these isn't an individual tragedy, because it is, but there are just 750 admissions to hospital each year in Britain for mental and behavioural problems relating to cannabis. There are 47,000 hospital admissions each year for mental and behavioural problems relating to alcohol. Now, obviously, more people use alcohol than use cannabis, but if you make the necessary adjustments, you're still six times more likely to experience mental and behavioural problems relating to alcohol than you are to cannabis. And this idea that there are lots of... I mean, where are they? You know, 30% of all adults use cannabis in their lifetime. As I said, 3 million people use it regularly. In the States, particularly in California, since 1996, where they've had legal medical marijuana, there are stronger and stronger forms of cannabis being used all the time, concentrates, tinctures, etc. Where are all these crazy people? Where are they? Rates of schizophrenia and psychosis are either stable or declining.
They've doubled in South London in the last 5 years.
Well, I'm sorry, David, but it's not true. And rates of schizophrenia and psychosis have been stable or declining for the last 50 years.
We're not at a dead end at all. You just watch. Everybody just watched there. Watch Mr. Reynolds shoot himself in the foot, and you didn't notice.
It was a polite way of saying, "Must move into the question."
Oh, okay, right. Good question.
Chap in the red jumper on the aisle there.
A question to the opposition. You talked about how it could affect and damage the lives of children. But surely if it was regulated even more, then, I mean, dealers don't care the age of the people they sell it to. But if it was put onto a regularised way, then surely you could have age restrictions, you could have medical restrictions, anything like that, to make it safer for the people that would buy it.
Yes, and criminality would spring up to supply that market, wouldn't it? When did you first smoke tobacco?
I haven't.
Well, I'll bet most people here did try tobacco. It used to be, when I was at school, it was behind the bike sheds and I was about 13. I was disgusted by it, so I never tried it again. But most people do use drugs very early, and I said at the end of my first bit, we will create a desirable adult behaviour if we legalise, so we shouldn't legalise. Because in the end, drugs use is about culture, and culture is driven. You will drive the culture. When you vote tonight, you're part of what drives the culture. And culture has changed adversely, as Peter described. You know, cannabis use was very low in the 60s, and I can give you the things that have happened in that event. We had the mid-90s, we had the legalisation campaign by Rosie Boycott, editor of The Independent on Sunday. Both have now rejected that view. Rosie Boycott's rejected it, and The Independent on Sunday has done it especially fulsomely. Don't interrupt. Especially fulsomely. They withdrew their applause for legalised cannabis. So a lot of people have changed their position, and that's the way it's going.
This argument simply does not work, and I think it needs to be acknowledged, because we can see in our society what happens. There are strict legal limits, both in this country and indeed in the United States, for the age at which you can drink alcohol, and similarly for the age at which you can purchase cigarettes. But it is not at all difficult to find, and again, this is generally in the rougher parts of the country, to find. I was recently in Birkenhead. My main purpose was to interview Frank Field, the Member of Parliament there, and a part of this was also to examine what was going on in the town for which he is a Member of Parliament. And in a park, in the morning, I found children aged 11, 12 and 13 drinking from litre bottles of vodka, which they had somehow or other managed to purchase. Illegal. If this substance is legal, sold in shops, promoted and advertised, making a profit, taxed, of course it will be, because that will be the first thing any Chancellor of the Exchequer, and one of the reasons why political parties are so relaxed about this, they see another tax opportunity. If it's taxed, then it will be available to people below the age at which you wish them to do. And this age question is so crucial. When cannabis was first introduced into this country, it was a late teenage, student age drug. Now it is a drug smoked in schools by children of 11, 12 and 13, and the younger you use it, Peter Reynolds ridiculously claims that it's not dangerous. The younger that you use it, the worse the damage is.
That's true.
And there is no question about what we do know for certain. Mental health is not an objective thing. It is not an objective thing, like, for instance, cancer of the lung or emphysema or degenerative heart disease. You can measure the effects of smoking tobacco in objectively diagnosable physical things. The diagnosis of mental illness is very, very sketchy. The American Psychiatric Association, which sets the boundaries of it, moves it every few years. 30 years ago, they classified homosexuality as a mental illness. Then they changed the designation of schizophrenia. How do you classify the mental state of somebody who, at the age of 15 or 16, drops out of doing any serious work at school and starts having all the... You will know perfectly well what happens to people who start smoking cannabis, apart from the way they become extremely boring. You will know what happens to them. Is that classified as mental illness? No, but it is. Now the point about this is that in the amazingly important Dunedin study, which was recently published, they established, because it's objectively accepted that there are measurements of human intelligence, they established that those people in that very large and very thorough study who had smoked cannabis during their school years declined in intelligence.
Nobody now, if it will do that to you,
you can see why he doesn't want that one to get out. Carry on sledging, Peter, but the point is you actually have proof there of the objectively measurable dangers of this drug. If it does that to you, what else is it doing to you? Would it be surprising, ladies and gentlemen, if cannabis, a strong, psychoactive, mind-bending drug, had an effect on the mental health of the people who used it? I mean, really, honestly, would it be a shock?
Would it be a shock if it cost the percentage?
There's a simple question to ask here. It's obviously going to be the case that if you have the legal but regulated sale of a product that some people who are not supposed to be getting it will get it in the way that you've described, the question should be, are they more likely to do so than they would be under the situation where it's supplied illegally? And the answer, I would say, is no. Not only that, but they will be getting a substance which is pure rather than bootleg, and therefore likely to be cut with all kinds of bad stuff or, as we've heard, actually grown to an artificially high degree of strength. So the fact is, nobody's ever going to say that you can have a regime where no children or vulnerable people will ever get hold of a substance that's not good for them. The question is how to minimise it, not absolutely, what it is. Absolutely. And that's the point.
The consequential harms of prohibition are also enormous. You know, the fact that all the social harms of cannabis, these are by far the greatest harms, as Stephen said earlier. You know, it's the criminal industry and the supply chain around it. You know, the fact that we have a rented property being taken over and destroyed, we have electricity being stolen, we have neighbourhoods being blighted by street dealers.
That won't stop.
It won't stop completely, but it'll be minimised. Exactly. Obviously, it's down to the government or the authority, the regulator, to establish a level of taxation which will be low enough to mean that people won't go to the black market, but high enough to mean that they will demonstrate enough income to fund itself.
Nabil, just there.
Sorry.
Well, I think I have to wait for the microphone.
Sorry, my question's for the opposition. Sir, you say people become boring when they start smoking cannabis, but many journalists in your field, for example, the Huffington Post, have stated that people who smoke cannabis are able to perceive complex issues in a very abstract manner, achieving Edward de Bono's lateral thinking in the best way possible. What is your response to that, sir?
Laughter. What's your
if you believe the Huffington Post, you really are desperate.
I can only add the comment that the woman who owns the Huffington Post was once described as the most upwardly mobile Greek since Icarus, and I think that's...
look what happened to him.
Question right in the middle there. That's right.
This is sort of a question to both sides. What do both sides of the argument make of the fact that in examples like Portugal, who have decriminalised to some extent, that I think use is meant to have gone down or something, and I'm not too sure. And also that in places like Mexico, I think it's like the president or the prime ministers or whatever, have actually said that they would prefer things like decriminalisation to end the war on drugs.
Of course, because as we were talking earlier, the consequential, there were 50,000 people dead in Mexico, principally because of the war against cannabis, which is there's massive demand for in the US. You know, the consequential harms of prohibition are diabolical. You know, when you go back to the original reason that cannabis was banned, as I said, the original reason it was banned in the US was the alcohol prohibition industry, but also Randolph Hearst, the newspaper magnate. It's strange how the same people get involved in this. Randolph Hearst, the newspaper magnate, also run massive timber plantations, and was an investor in the new oil industry. You know, when Henry Ford designed his Model T car, he designed it to run on hemp, on ethanol produced from hemp. And it remains the fact today that if you were to take 1/6 of the land currently dedicated to agriculture in the US and devote it to hemp from which you produce ethanol, then you would wipe out the United States' entire requirement for oil imports. Now, if you take that as a consequence of prohibition, you look at the wars and the death and the misery that's been caused by the oil markets, then you begin to see the real corruption and fundamental idiocy that is at the base of this. You know, this is cannabis. All right, just to give you an idea of the corruption that is inherent in this whole thing, this is cannabis. This is Sativex. It's a product produced by GW Pharmaceuticals. They're the only company in the world. All right, we're the only country, as I said, in Europe, that, and apart from France, that doesn't allow medicinal cannabis. But we're the only country in the world that has licensed a pharmaceutical company to grow hundreds of tons of cannabis every year to produce a medicine, despite the fact that the Home Office says there's no medicinal value in cannabis. And this medicine is 51% THC. Now, I've looked at it many, many times, and nowhere on it do I see a big label saying, warning, may cause psychosis. I mean, I can't see it. I don't know if anybody else can.
Have you written in and asked them to put one on?
I haven't.
It sounds like a good idea to me.
Buried in the product information is a warning that people who have any form of psychological difference should be careful about using it. But frankly, if the danger was even a fraction of what these gentlemen are claiming, then I'm quite sure that the Medicines and Healthcare Regulatory Agency would have insisted that there was a prominent warning.
We're fantastic, aren't we, at warning people about the dangers of medicines? I mean, it's one thing we're really terrifically good at. I would ask you to imagine these two gentlemen as actually the spokesman of a very large international company called Dope Co. And think of them as you would think of one of the big pharmaceutical companies coming here and telling you that you should take their drug, out of which huge amounts of money will then be made. Even though it might have some unfortunate side effects, but we don't want to worry about those because it will make you feel good. And in the course of making you feel good, it will make us a lot of money. This is fundamentally what this argument is about. Dopeco. That Dopeco wants a legalized market to sell a poison to people out of which it will make a lot of money, regardless of the fact that many people will suffer. Lots of drugs have interesting effects. I mean, for instance, most of you will have heard of thalidomide. Have you? Yeah. Well, the reason why thalidomide was a problem is because it was a very, very good drug if you wanted to stop having morning sickness while you were pregnant. Alas, unfortunately, it had a rather serious side effect, which the company which manufactured it wasn't very anxious for you to find out about. And when it was found out about, even then the company was very unwilling to admit liability, and it took a long, long, long newspaper campaign to get them to cough up. That's the attitude of people who want to sell you drugs. They'll tell you the good thing about it, they'll suppress the bad. Dopeco. Well, don't forget it. That's what they're after. They want your money. They don't care what happens to you.
Again, I can't let that pass.
Anybody
who's been to the United States is familiar with the kind of drug adverts you have on the United States, which lead me to some very strange conclusions about the kind of people who watch late-night American TV shows, I must say. They all seem to suffer from enlarged prostates, but never mind that. The typical thing I'm sure you all know, if you've seen these, is that you have a recommendation for the drug, and then there's an enormous list of things at the end that could happen as a bad result of the drug. At the end of that, you think, my God, why does anybody want to use this stuff? The point, of course, is that these are possible and real side effects which will occur in a minority, typically a small minority of cases. Take cannabis, for example. If you have a history in your family of mental psychosis, particularly schizophrenia, you should not use it at a young age. You really should not. But the point is, the overwhelming majority of people, that does not apply. Peter mentions thalidomide. What you may not know is that thalidomide has also been found now to be extremely good at treating certain mental health problems. But it can't be used for that because of its past history of producing defects in unborn children. The point is that now it could be used perfectly well, but everyone would know that you don't use it if you think you might be pregnant. That's the kind of basic rule that applies to any kind of substance. And that's why that kind of argument, oh, drug X or substance X might have some bad effects in some cases, therefore nobody should use it, is a ridiculous argument.
Can I deal with Portugal?
No, because we must move on to the question. Lady just there, please.
This is for the proposition, and I just wanted to ask, in the campaign literature we've been given, it talks about the monopolisation of Sativex by GW.
Yeah.
And given that the crux of the argument of this campaign literature seems to be we should legalise cannabis because of its medicinal benefits, how are you suggesting that legalising it would prevent sort of monopolisation of cannabis by pharmaceutical companies?
Well, I mean, that allows me to finish the point I was making about this product earlier on, because this product is, GW Pharmaceuticals has been licensed to produce this product, but the Home Secretary actually doesn't have the powers under the Misuse of Drugs Act to issue the licence that she has, because it says under the Misuse of Drugs Act that she may, for a Schedule 1 drug, which cannabis is, it says that she has the power to issue licences for special purposes such as research. And it's quite clear that the legislation has been drafted specifically to avoid the issuing of licences for commercial gain. And then, so it's illegal under the Misuse of Drugs Act. It's also completely illegal under the United Nations Single Convention, which prohibits any trafficking in cannabis. I mean, the way that we'd prevent the monopolisation is, what we would do is we would allow other people to have licences. Now, there's a grower in Holland called Bedrocan, which is the Dutch government's official supplier of medicinal cannabis. They already export all over Europe, to every country in Europe apart from France and Britain. And tomorrow, if people were allowed to have their doctor prescribe the medicinal cannabis, tomorrow Bedrocan could be exporting to Britain. You know, and something else which you may not know, which is absolutely outrageous, is that if you're a resident of another EU country where you've been prescribed medicinal cannabis, then under the protection of the Schengen Agreement, you're perfectly legal to bring that cannabis to Britain, and there's no restrictions on you using it whatsoever. So you could sit there, not here, obviously, apart from the smoking ban, you could sit outside and you could smoke your cannabis or eat it or vaporise it or whatever you want to do, but if a British resident was sitting next to you, they could be arrested and sent to jail. But I mean, what we need is we need a market in medicinal cannabis. I really believe we need a market in cannabis for all adults. Mm. You know, but the fact that people in pay, I mean, I have seen, this is the reason I do this, because I have seen in the last 5 years the absolutely transformational effect that cannabis has on some people's lives. People with MS and Crohn's disease, particularly. Absolutely transformational effect. People who are locked in pain and suffering and disability, who, because they're able to use cannabis, are able to lead a normal, productive life. And the fact that we criminalise people for doing that, when we're permitting this thing on a completely legal basis, but we're permitting it, and on the other hand, we're sending the police to knock people's doors down and put them in jail when they're sick and ill just because they want to use a little bit of cannabis. It's not unjust, it's obscene.
Can I answer that? Because he denies it now, but there's an organisation in the US called NORMAL, the National Organisation for the Reform of Marijuana Laws, and a guy called Keith Stroopland ran that, and he was quoted as saying many, many years ago, we will use medicinal cannabis as a Trojan horse.
Well, we know that, but I mean, that may be him,
that's not us.
That's what
Peter's just doing. He's using it as a Trojan horse.
That's medicinal. Nonsense. I'm talking about people in pain and suffering.
It would not surprise me at all if cannabis has some medicinal use. It's got 400 compounds in it, and we get a lot of our medicines from plants anyway. But it's irrelevant to the debate that we're having here. The debate here is about legalising cannabis. The medicinal use is a complete red herring to which you should pay.
No, right. It's the most important argument of all.
Well, can I make a small point about this? Because it is very important to note it. There are problems about classifying cannabis as a medicine because it's very difficult to do double-blind tests with a drug that no one can take without knowing they've taken it. The person who's given the placebo sugar pill will invariably know, so that's extremely difficult. And also there is the second difficulty, and Professor Leslie Iverson, who's no friend of mine in this argument, will concede this. The second difficulty is that cannabis, by creating a euphoria, will often make people feel better even when they're not better.
What's the matter with that?
Come on, Peter, let me finish, because it's an important point. I completely concede, as does David, that there is possibility that there may be medicinal causes in this drug. But if you were serious about that, you would surely not ally yourself with the campaign to make it generally available to everybody. If you genuinely believe that it could cure or provide tremendous symptomatic relief to something like Crohn's disease, you wouldn't ally yourself with a bunch of people who wanted to make it legal throughout the world and have it sold to 11-year-old children.
You'd narrow your campaign. That's outrageous.
You'd narrow your campaign to a specific...
That's outrageous.
You see, he won't let me finish because he doesn't want it said.
No.
You'd narrow your campaign to a very specific one to get it legalised for that use. You would not associate yourselves with a bunch of people who want 12-year-old children to use it. This is a vitally important medicine and it needs to be licensed responsibly by the people who do that. There are many medicines which are very similar, for instance, to heroin, which are used in the National Health Service because they have extremely good uses, not because people campaigned for heroin to be legal, but because people recognised they were medically useful and campaigned
heroin
for
is
that.
Legal.
Completely different matter.
Heroin is legally regulated. Dimorphine is legally regulated.
Can I tell you about legally regulated drugs? The drugs causing the most problems in the US and Canada now are the legally regulated prescription drugs. You couldn't imagine a tighter regime, and yet they cause most of the addiction problems, particularly to Native Americans.
The chap right at the back in the red fleece, please. Right at the back.
Surely in a free country, we let people make their own decisions and choices based on the information, even if something does have bad social or bad psychological effects. That's why we don't criminalise heroin. That's why we don't criminalise alcohol, or we don't criminalise tobacco, or we don't criminalise the Daily Mail, for example.
It's an interesting thing that that people have developed this idea that the freedom to make yourself stupid, acquiescent, passive and general government fodder is in some way comparable to the freedoms of speech, thought, and assembly. On the contrary, it's the opposite. I would have thought if I were a government which wanted to have an easily manipulated ad mass population that would never rise in protest against its incompetence or its brutality or its desire to snoop on me or its desire to shut down freedom of the press or make us all carry identity cards or whatever it happened to be that it was doing, I would really, really want a doped population myself. And the other thing is that you're perfectly free, as it happens, because the law isn't enforced at the moment. You're free to smoke cannabis. And you're also free to go and burgle somebody's home. And you're free to do all kinds of things. But if you do it afterwards, you take the risk of being arrested, prosecuted, and imprisoned. But it is absurd, it seems to me, to elevate your self-stupefaction to the same level as those liberties for which hundreds of people died and suffered and were tortured. And as for your cheap shot about closing down newspapers, I think it gives quite a clue as to how your mind works. And I would say, I would be much more.
Your mind
I would
is not
be much,
allowed to
no,
work
no, 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 no. I know
you
this
know.
Argument. I'd stand up against
do.
It. If someone is seriously prepared to stand or sit in a public assembly and recommend, even as a joke, for many a true word is said in jest, the closing down of a newspaper which says things he disagrees with, there's something pretty fundamentally wrong with him.
Look, sorry. I think what Peter is making a false distinction here. The point is that the kind of, he thinks, maybe correctly, misguided use of freedom and the more serious uses that he compares them with derive from the same fundamental principle, which is that you should be free to do whatever you want so long as you do not cause direct harm to another person, defining the word harm quite precisely. That's the John Stuart Mill argument, which I fully support. Now, I agree with what he says, actually. There is a serious case, which, in fact, people like Mill were interested in, to say that for a free society to work effectively, you need a citizenry which is educated, sober, self-controlled, and therefore able to hold their masters to account, or even, if need be, chuck them out. The question is, how do you get there? And the point of my argument is that the way to get a citizenry of that kind is not to treat them in a paternalistic way as children who have to be banned from doing stuff that is bad for them. What you need to do is to have a grassroots cultural movement which will promote and develop those habits of virtue, if you will, just as we did in the 19th century. And I think that's the most effective way to go in what you want is a kind of free society. And I agree with Peter that lots of the things that our masses would be trying to get up to us are, you know, definitely not things that we want, and they're up to no good.
Except that it is precisely the children whom we most need to protect from this drug. It is precisely the children, the 11, 12, and 13-year-olds who are most
in danger. The way we protect the children is by taking the market out of the hands of criminals and putting it into the hands of responsible, licensed outlets. Now, I'm not suggesting, as we've already said, I'm not suggesting that's going to wipe the problem out, but it's going to minimise it. You know, the financial argument as well. Currently, we spend £500 million every single year on the criminal justice system for cannabis alone. We commissioned independent research last year that shows if you taxed and regulated cannabis, you'd produce a net gain to the UK economy of up to £9.3 billion. Now, I would suggest that a large chunk of that should go into drugs education. There's an awful lot left over to go into perhaps more general education and health spending. You know, but this argument about the harms of cannabis, the prohibitionists flip-flop on this all the time. You know, first of all, they say it makes you crazy. Then when that argument doesn't work, they say it makes you lazy. Then they go back again to saying it makes you crazy. This idea that it stupefies you, stupefication is Peter's favourite description for this, I mean, that just doesn't match with this idea of it of creating or being associated with psychosis, because psychosis is essentially produced through a heightened awareness, which is what cannabis does do. So, this, so you know, they try to have it both ways, and it's nonsense. Cannabis is the least harmful psychoactive substance known to man. And you know who said that most recently? It was Judge Francis Young of the DEA, the Drug Enforcement Administration, not somebody who's normally on my side.
Time's catching up with us, so we can take a quick couple of questions. George, you get the back. You over there now. The chap just there next to you, then, and then the chap right in front of him.
My question is for the opposition, and it is: why would anyone buy drugs from a drug dealer when they could buy it safer, better quality, and more conveniently from your local corner shop?
Well, let me. I told you.
Take it out of the. take it out of hand.
Right. People can buy tobacco from a tobacco shop, a tobacconist. I told you that at one stage 25% of the UK tobacco market was smuggled counterfeit or both. It's a bit less now, but it's still pretty high. And a lot of those tobacco, that those cigarettes that were smuggled in, were some of them were absolute rubbish. And the absolute rubbish in those smuggled cigarettes goes to Scotland, because the Scots drink and smoke anything, as you know. Any Scots in the room? Scotland has the worst diet, the biggest alcohol problem, and the biggest drugs problem, and the biggest tobacco problem in the UK. It's true. And a lot of those cigarettes went to Scotland, and people bought them. People buy them. They bought it because it was cheaper. So when our colleagues over here talk about putting tax on, tax is an incentive for the traffickers. Absolute incentive. The traffickers want legalisation. They'll make more money because there'll be a bigger market. And there'll be more.
I should have thought that a room full of people like this would be more suspicious of big corporations. What we're being told is, take it out of the hands of gangsters and put it into the hands of people like the people who flood the country with disgusting hamburgers that make you fat and revolting soft drinks that make you ill, and put in supermarket sweets within the reach of children so they'll get them. Do we really think that big corporations are so nice that we can trust them with a mind-altering drug?
I
think Canada, they can't even handle 50 drinks.
Actually, but think about that. Maybe you don't like McDonald's or Burger King, but who would you rather have a business dealing with, McDonald's or the Sicilian Mafia? That's the kind of question you need to ask.
I must answer that, because in 36 years in customs, I never came across the Sicilian mafia engaged with the
British counterparts.
Hang on. It isn't their British counterpart. It was mostly people like Howard Marks, actually, Mr. Hippie. You know, the Sicilian mafia has never been engaged in the British cannabis trade. What they have been engaged in, the Sicilian mafia, is the British smuggled cigarette trade.
Well, and let me... that was the other point I was going to make. The implication is that if you have any level of tax, people are going to rather buy illegal substances, which, as you correctly heard from David, are rubbish, rather than buy the high-quality substance of the legal supplier. That is not the case. The point is, as you heard earlier from Peter here on my side, there's an optimum level of tax which will yield the maximum income and will not create the incentive to go to the smugglers. The reason why, in places like Manchester, as much as 40% of cigarettes are sold by dodgy customers in pubs illegally and smuggled, is because the level of taxation has become too high. It's not because the substance is sold legally and subject to tax in the first place. That means there's a matter of
again,
public policy.
Again, there. That's not true. I said to you earlier that tobacco is the most smuggled substance in the world. It's true, it is. And it's smuggled widely, even where there are very low tax rates on it. And why is it smuggled? Because organised crime loves addictive substances and behaviours. That's why organised crime is involved with gambling, and that's why organised crime is involved with prostitution, and that's why organised crime is involved with tobacco, and why it's involved with drugs. And it would remain involved. The organised crime argument is a non-starter. It's absolute garbage, and yet they keep parroting it, and they've heard these arguments before from me. It's rubbish. Utter rubbish.
Well, we don't see guns involved.
Mr. Reynolds, I'm afraid we only have time for two more questions. And I think it's going to be the chap there, George, please, who had up the entire time. And the chap without the seat.
Extension, we started late. Can we go
on? Sorry.
I'm happy to start.
I think they lock the room eventually, so
that's okay.
I don't want to go out to the room with Brandon.
You mentioned about having an effect on other parts of society.
Could you put the microphone?
Okay, I'll start again. To the opposition, you mentioned earlier about the cannabis having an effect on parts of society we don't see. So firstly, it's obviously not being stopped by it being illegal. That's still going on. Secondly, a lot of the money involved in that is going entirely into the gangs in that area, which I'd argue is making the situation even worse. Wouldn't it be better to legalise it and take money out of the hands of people that then spend that money on guns?
You've not been listening to me, have you? You know, I've told you about 25% of the UK tobacco market. It's far bigger.
75% of the money away.
Let the panel answer, would you?
The first point is that, as I've rather laboriously tried to demonstrate in this book, which is on sale at no leading booksellers and has not been widely reviewed because the drug cult is so common in the newspaper industry as well as in other cases. No, it's perfectly true. The penetration of British culture, the number of senior politicians in this country who have been serious drug users, the number of journalists who are, the number of people in the academy who are is immensely high. So one fights very hard against fashion if one wants to make the case that David and I are making tonight. And you will find that it's not particularly easy to do, and it makes it all the more honourable when you vote against the appalling case which is being made by the opposition. But the purpose of the book was to point out that there is no serious attempt to curb or interdict demand for cannabis in this country. There are various showy and feeble attempts to interdict supply, but not demand. And the reason why it spreads so much is precisely because of this. And in the poor areas, it's worse. People go on and on about gangsters. They don't listen to what David says about tobacco or alcohol. You go to Boston in Lincolnshire, there's a very, very thriving illegal alcohol market for the same reason. The taxation makes it an opportunity for people who wish to smuggle to move in and make very large sums of money. If you legalize it, you won't take the gangs away. And at this point, just has to sink in. You will not, by legalizing it, remove the gangs. You will instead have the gangs working in competition with Dopeco, the great multinational, which will be advertising and selling and promoting the drugs. So you, instead of having one source of supply, you'll have two in competition with each other, fighting over the matter. That can't be better, can it? Dopeco might have better advertisement. They've certainly got, in the case of Stephen, they've got a fantastic spin doctor who will be able to go on television and say that it's perfectly all right, this stuff, but they have not got any better intentions in the end than the gangs. The same intention is there. We sell you this stuff, we don't care about the consequences. One other point about tax. We're told that if you set tax at the right level, there'll be no smuggling. Well, I suppose you're going to get George Osborne and Ed Balls to get together and promise, are you, not to raise tax on cannabis because they've run out of money from any other source. Have you ever met a chancellor who can make a pledge like that? Tax is levied on taxable substances because the government is constantly greedy for money, apart from anything else, to pour into the huge pit of debt which it has created and the interest rates which it has to pay on that debt. There is no guarantee that tax, once implemented on cannabis, will remain at a level which will not stimulate smuggling and criminal activity. Rather, the contrary.
What I say to you, sir, is that you are the voice of common sense, and you're absolutely right.
I'm not sure who thinks he is anymore, actually.
A couple of very quick points, because we do need to get on to other questions. One of them is, David earlier said, there's all these other things that he mentioned which are associated with organised crime. The point that all those things have in common is that they are products which there is a high demand and which are either outright outlawed or highly, highly regulated by governments in such a way that they're effectively impossible to get for many people who'd like to have them. And that is why they're associated with criminality. I could add pornography to the list as the one he did there. I reject his point. And the point also is the trend. It's not a question of whether or not there's smuggling. It's a question of what is the trend in the smuggling. And the trend is in tobacco in particular, is for the amount of smuggling to increase because of the increasingly stringent levels of taxation. I share Peter's mistrust of George Osborne and the Chancellor, but then it's up to people like myself and I hope him as well, to hold the politicians' feet to the fire, and this is another matter. I do say, by the way, very quickly, I actually agree with Peter's point that the policy we have, which is trying to interdict supply while leaving demand untouched, is simply completely wrong-headed. If you are going to have prohibition, then you have to go after demand. That's the only kind of prohibition that has any chance of success, and that even then, it's still a very low chance, but it's certainly better than what we have, which is the worst of all possible worlds, basically.
And the last question, George? Yeah, over there.
George,
Mr. Hitchens, I would just say it's nothing but a lie to say that we're free to smoke cannabis in this country. I went through a degree, a master's, 3 years of employment, and then lost my teaching position because I was found with cannabis on me outside of school time. Somehow it got into the school's hands and I lost my job. I now can't put that on my CV as a reference entirely because of cannabis. As I say, I went through my university, my master's, without any problem. As a result of this one conviction, I now have to lie about 3 years on my teaching CV, which has severely handicapped me. I otherwise than that have no harm towards, or have played no harmful role towards, some upstanding member of society. But this has really kind of ruined a certain part of my life. So I don't really see how I benefited.
So there must be a question.
So anyway, that's just the point. It's a lie that we're free to smoke cannabis. Basically, the point is that I want to raise to you two. Have you ever socialised or been with or taken part in yourself alcohol in a social context and been slightly tipsy? If so, what is it? Why is it okay for you to be tipsy on a drug of alcohol of your choice, yet it's not okay for us to be a bit stoned? Why is that? Why is that? Why is that the case? Peter, if you could give me an answer instead of just arrogance, it would be.
Though the heart sinks, I'll give you an answer. Because I have first the first point, I have to say you must have been extraordinarily unlucky or imprudent to get prosecuted for taking cannabis. Yeah. But you were. But on the other hand, I would also say you knowingly broke the known law of the country, and you can't, after that, complain at the consequences. And I can't. I don't see why anybody should sympathise with you for doing that. It is illegal. You broke the law, and that's the consequence you must take. What I don't know what point it is you're making here. Don't know what the point is that you're making. What would be if I said, as a matter of fact, you keep interrupting me so much, I can't answer your question. As a matter of fact, I barely drink alcohol at all. But assuming the answer to your question was yes, what difference would it make to the question before us? If it is the case, as I have argued here, and you probably weren't listening at the time, if it is the case that alcohol is already a very dangerous poison loose among us, doing dreadful damage to many people, and indeed their families and those who depend upon them and their colleagues, and is something which, if it were being invented and introduced now, and it reached the stage of use that cannabis has, I would campaign just as vigorously for its banning and its driving out of the country as I do with cannabis. What has this got to do with the argument about having another dangerous drug unleashed in the middle of this by rapacious commercial forces represented by these gentlemen? Why is that an argument? How stupid do you have to be not to see that it is not an argument for legalising cannabis?
I'll be here all night if you will. You said that in the last debate.
No. The proposition came on your behalf.
Oh, I think you're a victim of prohibition, sir. As I started off my initial speech, you know, there are 1,200 people who've been sent to jail immediately for possession. There are tens of thousands of people, in fact, a million people who are alive in this country today who have criminal records for cannabis, who quite possibly can't travel specifically to the States and have their lives and their careers ruined by a completely immoral policy and immoral law. You know, it is fundamentally immoral to say that you can use that drug and arbitrarily we decide that you can't, and when you do, you'll go to jail for it.
Exactly.
It's fundamentally immoral.
I would just paraphrase, you know, John Stuart Mill's principle that the only grounds on which you can restrict people's liberty or punish them is to prevent direct harm to others, and that your own benefit or good is not sufficient grounds. So even if I was to agree with Peter that you're doing something which is bad for you, there's no grounds on which to stop you doing that. And since you've not harmed anyone, it's an outrage that you have in fact been punished in this way.
How do you know he hasn't harmed anyone? How does he know he hasn't harmed anyone?
I'm going on what he said.
You don't know, he doesn't. Actually, he hasn't harmed anyone. He might not care.
Mr. Reynes, you have 30 seconds if you want to contribute.
Yeah, I mean, we just had Stuart Mill. I've actually kept this quote. This is a quote from Mill. I mean, the one that's used by cannabis campaigners is over himself and over his own mind and body, the individual is sovereign. That's the one that people on that side always quote. But there is another one. The only purpose for which power can be rightfully exercised over any member of a civilised society against his will is to prevent harm to others. And that's the phrase, isn't it? He says, and I quote, in the context of morality, law and punishment, Mill says, and I quote him directly, whenever, in short, there's a definite damage or definite risk of damage, either to an individual or to the public, the case is taken out of the province of liberty and placed in that of morality or law. Punishment is seen to be right. For such actions as are prejudicial to the interests of others, the individual is accountable to society and may be subjected either to social or legal punishment if society is of the opinion that the one or the other is requisite for its protection.
Exactly. And can I just quickly call for that?
No, sorry, Mr.
Social or legal? And socialism is the more useful one.
Now, but thank you very much. Thanks again for a great bunch of questions, and we must move on to summations before we are locked in. So without further ado, summing up the opposition, please, Mr. Hitchens.
I must ask you here to consider very carefully what you do. This isn't just something where you show how fashionable you are and how much you want to be liked by your friends, or just an evening's entertainment. This is an issue on which your generation will have to decide, ultimately, whether you want to take one road or another. The road which you are being offered here by the supporters of the vast commercial interests which wish to unleash into Western society a drug which has already done considerable damage and whose widespread use by the young people of the West has devastated countries such as Colombia and Mexico through their selfish unwillingness to consider the effects of their use of it on the people who produce it and the desperate criminal circumstances which that visits on them. These people are offering you a complete pig in a poke. You cannot begin to know what is going to be unleashed on our society if they get their way. If powerful commercial forces, the sort that manufacture hamburgers, the sort that manufacture soft drinks, the sort that run the supermarkets, the sort that make the motor cars, the sort that run the oil industry, if those forces, with all the power of persuasion and money at their command, are able to market in this society a drug which, even while it is still officially illegal, Peter Reynolds admits hospitalizes 750 people a year. Imagine how many more will end up in hospital if he gets his way. Imagine that. Ask yourself how much you actually know about cannabis and mental illness. How many people you know who have been affected by it and you thought maybe they're not doing particularly well. And then answer me this if you care to put it in your mind. If I tell you the story of Henry Kirby, can you just set it to one side and say, that will never happen to me or anybody I know? And if it happens to me, ask yourself, how many people will suffer if you become personally mentally ill? How will you suffer if a child of yours becomes irreversibly mentally ill? Ask yourself those questions, voting, and then ask yourself the final thing, how you in this very privileged place can sit here and unleash upon people far less fortunate than yourselves a drug with such potential to do harm to them and to the society in which they live. And I beg you to vote against this motion and against the powers of the government.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hitchens. And now something for the proposition, please, Mr. Reynolds.
Very, very important that you stand up here against this ridiculous experiment of prohibition, which has only been going on for 80 years, and look at what the disaster it's caused. Just to remind you of those four main reasons. Why should we legalise cannabis? Why should we legally regulate cannabis? To enable its enormous medicinal and therapeutic benefits. And the enormous number of people that can benefit, hundreds of thousands of people in this country who are denied that relief based on a policy which is fundamentally immoral. Because, as I was just saying, this policy says, arbitrarily, we will decide what you can and what you can't do. It doesn't make any difference that scientifically that particular substance is hundreds of times less harmful than this one. We decide, if you don't do what we say, you go to jail. So it's a fundamentally immoral policy. Medicinal and therapeutic benefits. Protect children and the vulnerable. It's the defence that these two put up against this overwhelming argument that if you take something out of the hands of criminals and put it in the hands of a regulated system is absurd. You know, obviously, anybody, as the gentleman up there said, anybody is going to want to go, would prefer to go to a place to buy their cannabis or indeed any product where they know what it is, it's properly labelled, they know it's safe. The third point to reduce all social harms, the massive harms from organised crime. The crime around cigarettes and alcohol, we don't see the violence and the human trafficking involved in that we see with the cannabis market at the moment. It's preposterous. We don't. It's preposterous to suggest they're the same thing. And finally, public health. You know, we everybody in this room consumes drugs. All of us do, whether it's caffeine, whether it's alcohol, whether it's cannabis, whether it's cocaine. We all consume drugs of some type or another. And if cannabis was legally available, as Professor David Nutt said just recently, it could reduce alcohol consumption by up to 25%. And that would transform public health in Britain. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Reynolds. And now it's time for our closing vote. And again, this is a vote based on the merits of the arguments you've heard, please. And there'll be no abstentions either, either vote with the proposition or with the opposition. And hands nice and high in the air, please, especially if you're at the back. So those this evening voting with the proposition, please. And those voting with the opposition, please. Justifiably, that does demand a recount. Lucky you. It's not quite Florida, but it's almost there. It's within two votes. So those voting with the proposition... hands nice and high, please, in the air.
Come on, high.
Proposition. The proposition, the ones that go first.
Doko, that's what I thought.
And those voting with the opposition.
It's empty, unfortunately.
Thank you very much. I can therefore declare why a very slim margin nonetheless, the opposition have won this evening's debate. I wore the bottle of wine to my favourite question. There were a lot of good questions. I actually quite liked Joel's rather dim question, but my favourite one was came from in the middle, I think, just there, regarding legalisation of cannabis and the monopolisation by the pharmaceutical companies. So thank you very much. Congratulations.
Tonight's debate. Apparently, there were over 100 people watching live stream tonight. I know someone in Italy that's watching. In the UK, we've got people in London, Oxford, Southampton. So I'm glad they didn't all come tonight because they wouldn't fit in this room. But great to see that there's so many people watching. Just quickly, for next week, I'm sad to say it's our last workshop and last debate of the term. Aww. Very sad. So make sure you don't miss those two. The debate next week is This House Believes the Afghanistan War Has Been a Failure. While there's so many people there, just to let you know, term two, we have some cracking motions coming up. We're going to be debating the existence of God, the death penalty, abortion. We've got the influence of media in politics. So, and there's also opportunities for you to get involved and debate yourself. So definitely come along to those. Whilst we're back to the guys, just listen up a sec. While we're back to the usual Friday debate next week in Amory Parker Moot Room, it's starting at 7 o'clock. That is because there is a talk by Oliver Letwin, who is coming in for Conservative Future to do a talk. I recommend you come to our debate and then go to theirs. It's straight afterwards, so we've pulled our debate forward for them. So definitely come along to that. Debsock Winter Ball is on Tuesday. If you've reserved a ticket, you need to buy it, surprisingly. So you need to do that tonight or Monday. That's your last call. I would say let's all go to the pub. We won't all fit in the pub, so some people should stay. But everyone else, to the ramp. And I'm here with Peter Reynolds after a very fiery debate here. First of all, how do you think the debate went?
Oh, well, I enjoyed it. I thought it was vigorous, as usual. I'm amazed we lost, but, you know, sometimes in defeat, you have to try and be as gracious as you can.
We have to say it was very close, so you must feel quite happy about that.
Well, yes, but I think really, I mean, we must have done a very bad job of it. I must have done a very bad job of it, because really the evidence for the legal regulation of cannabis is overwhelming. And I find it astonishing, really, that we failed to convince the audience. So, but, you know, mea culpa.
Do you think part of your failing to convince the audience was actually the promotional literature you handed out, which focused solely on the medicinal purposes of marijuana?
Well, that's marijuana is a bad word. Marijuana was a word dreamt up by the American prohibitionists to deliberately place a racist slur on the term. It's not marijuana, it's cannabis. As far as I'm concerned, I'm going to continue to smoke cannabis, whatever the law says. So it's not an issue about my personal wishes. I think the reason that I do what I do is because of the medicinal use. And, I mean, as I said, what I advocate is legal regulation. And if we were to get to legal regulation first by it simply being available for medicinal use, then I would consider that to be a victory. And I believe that's something that we should do today.
So you think of it like a stepping stone, because do you not think that by making cannabis legal, like alcohol is illegal, like cigarettes are legal, that children are more likely to engage with it? I mean, I know we've spoken about children getting it behind bike sheds. I'm not sure how widespread that actually is. But
the facts about this, the evidence about this are, for instance, that Britain has the largest number of children using cannabis and the lowest age at first use in Europe. Holland, which has legally regulated availability to adults, has a far higher... I think the average age of first use in Holland is 19 and a half years, whereas in Britain it's 13 and a half years. And in Holland, you know, adults can go and buy cannabis from a coffee shop. But if you go and try and go buy cannabis from a coffee shop and you look as if you're under 18, you'll be asked for ID. You know, it's unarguable. You know, proper regulation will make it more difficult. It won't rule it out, but it will make it more difficult for children to get it.
More difficult, yes, but say parents think that cannabis is now legal, I can smoke it at home, this is all fine, so therefore children are more likely to get hold of it. I mean, for alcohol, for example, I'm not sure there are many people that actually start drinking at the age of 18. I'm sure it's actually many years lower than that.
But the evidence is that where you introduce legal regulation, consumption goes down. I mean, that is the evidence. I know it may be counterintuitive, but that's what's happened in Portugal. That's what's happened in the Czech Republic. That's what's happened in the 18 states in America where medical marijuana is now permitted. When you make something legally available, consumption goes down. I mean, a lot of it, I think, is to do with forbidden fruits. I know that's the reason I started smoking cannabis. I started smoking cannabis when I was 14. And I know the real reason I did it in the first place was because I was doing something naughty and exciting and adventurous. That's what started me off, and I think that's what starts a lot of children off.
But obviously, it still wouldn't be legal for children aged 14, so it would still be a forbidden... They're still going to continue doing it.
That's right, but there aren't going to be scumbag dealers standing on street corners trying to sell it to children, because there'll be a legitimate supply chain. And it would be foolish, as the gentleman up here said earlier on, it would be foolish for somebody to go to some street dealer when they know they can go to a licensed outlet down the shop, they can get it in a nice little packet that tells them what the percentage of THC is, percentage of CBD, they know it hasn't been sprayed with glass, they know it hasn't got anything else in it, they know it'll be a much better product.
Well, I think that's a good point to end on. Thank you very much. It's been very helpful talking to you. I hope you enjoyed the debate and I hope you've enjoyed your visit to Exeter. Thank you. Hi. I'm Lydia and I'm here now with Peter Hitchens after a victory at the debate. How do you think it went?
Well, I think it went very well. I think the right argument won.
It won, yes. Would you have rathered a slightly higher margin of victory?
If you're arguing against the stream and against the tide and against fashion, it's always rather satisfying to win at all. Normally in the modern world where fashion is very powerful and people are taught what to think rather than how to think, it's quite hard for conservative ideas to win votes. You often win the argument, but you very seldom win the vote. So if you win the argument and the vote, it's a good evening.
It's good. You talked about it being the fashion. Do you think it's a particular fashion within student culture?
I think it's fashion in the country as a whole and has been since I was at university in the early 70s and before that. The idea that taking drugs and particularly smoking cannabis is cool is just very common and has become pretty much accepted. And we now begin to see the very serious results of it, particularly as it begins to be smoked by children. 11, 12, 13 or 14, for whom it has really catastrophic results. And also the other thing is it's being used much more intensely and we're seeing the long-term effects on people's mental health beginning to emerge. And we're also at the same time seeing a very powerful, very well-funded campaign for its legalisation. And what purpose could that have, given that it is effectively decriminalised in this country? Legalisation could only be intended to make it commercially available.
Well, you mentioned children. You speak about children of age 11, 12, 13 smoking cannabis. How widespread do you think this is? Because I'm not sure personally. I mean, I know we're a very privileged place, but I don't come from a very privileged place, and I don't think any of those children were smoking cannabis.
Well, I don't think it's possible to come out with a direct factual statement until someone's done the survey. But I think if you asked parents of children at secondary schools, which start at age 11 in this country, whether cannabis is prevalent in those schools, or if you actually went and visited a lot of British secondary schools at lunchtime or indeed at the end of the day, you would find cannabis being openly dealt among 11, 12 and 13 year olds. And I know of one person who, exposed to it at that age, has had his life changed forever disastrously. And I think one is quite enough. I think the numbers are practically quite a lot bigger than that.
Okay, well that's all interesting to know. Do you think by carrying on as we are, the issue is only going to get worse? Because people talk about only getting a slap on the wrist, and do you think this is strong enough at the moment?
Well, I think if you carry on as you are, you will get eventually a head of water building up behind the idea of decriminalisation, precisely because the drug has penetrated so deep into society that it will be increasingly difficult to stop it. I think we may be at the last point now in our civilisation where we could say we don't want to have cannabis as well as alcohol and tobacco. And we could do it. It would be an effort and it would be costly, but I think the benefit of it would be very great and many people would be saved from horrible tragedies. And these are horrible tragedies. Those people who have experienced them, the woman I spoke about, whose husband suddenly went completely round the bend in their house and had to be taken away by 12 police officers, that's the end of a happy life for him and for everybody associated with him. And if your child becomes seriously mentally ill, then that's the end of a happy life for you. And this is much more common than people know. It isn't being measured. There's no serious state-backed or commercially-backed research going on about it at the moment. I'd like people to find out more. If we did find out more, I think we might armour ourselves against it. But this could be the last chance we have put an end to it.
Okay, well, thank you very much. It's been a pleasure speaking to you. Congratulations. We hope you've enjoyed the debate here at Exeter. Thank you and good night.